Hello everyone. In this video, we shall consider some of the commonly used instruments in the experimental pharmacology. Now, organ bath is one of the very important instrument which is used for carrying out the experiments on isolated tissue. Now, coming to the development and the parts of this particular assembly. This is the scientist Rudolf Magnus who actually designed the arrangement of this bath for utilization for experiments on the isolated tissue way back in 1904. Now this particular assembly, it consists of various parts. So let us see one by one. So first and foremost, it consists of a water bath. Okay, a water jacket is present which is made up of perspex, okay, which is fitted with an electrical heater. So this water bath, okay, so as the name implies, it will be filled with water to maintain the conditions. Okay, now this assembly or this organ bath, it is designed in such a way that it provides a suitable environment for the tissue. Now this is basically designed for the study on the isolated tissue. So once a tissue is isolated from the animal's body, it needs to be maintained in a particular environmental conditions. Okay, so these are known as experimental conditions. So to keep that tissue alive, so once it is removed out of the body from that animal, it should be provided with all those conditions, okay, which are available inside the body so that the tissue will remain alive till you perform the experiment on that. Okay, so basically you're providing all those conditions like all the nutrients, oxygen, the temperature, etc. So all those situations are provided in that particular organ bath. So it is consisting of a water bath to maintain the particular temperature. So it will be filled with water and that water will be heated to a particular temperature which is same as that of the body temperature of that particular animal from which that tissue is isolated. So there will be a electrical heater which will be provided over there. A temperature sensor will be there to sense the changes in the temperature, because when in a water bath, obviously the water, you cannot just go on heating the water. It should be heated in a controlled manner. So there should be a sensor which will check what is the temperature in the water bath continuously. So a temperature sensor is provided. A pump is also provided for the water circulation. So whatever water is present in this water bath, it should be continuously circulating. Otherwise, what will happen? The water just in the vicinity of the heater will be heated too much. So to uniformly heat the water throughout the water bath, a pump is provided in the recent or the new assemblies. Earlier stirrers used to be provided, but nowadays a pump is available which will be continuously pumping the water, circulating the water in the water bath. Okay, so it will help in maintaining the uniform heating of the entire water bath. Okay, then the next part is a cylindrical tissue bath, okay, or organ bath it may be called. And so it is made up of glass and it is meant for suspending the tissue in the physiological salt solution. So this particular glass cylindrical tube into which you are actually placing your tissue, it will contain the physiological salt solution. We will consider what a physiological salt solution is in detail at the end of this session. So basically this physiological salt solution, it is a specialized solution which is prepared by adding certain chemicals to it to provide all the necessary ions and the energy to that particular tissue, because you are isolating. So it needs that supply of proper ions like calcium, potassium, magnesium, okay, or energy in the form of maybe glucose. Then there are certain components meant for contraction which will help in relaxation of the tissue. So all such components are present in this physiological salt solution. So it is appropriately selected depending upon the type of experiment. So this physiological salt solution is present in this tissue bath into which the tissue is suspended. Then the next part is a warming coil. Now generally the physiological salt solution is kept in the reservoir outside the water bath. So it is at a normal temperature. So when you are adding it, or when you are allowing that physiological salt solution to enter into your tissue bath, where you have placed the tissue actually. So it, while entering, that physiological salt solution should be at the ideal temperature, the temperature which has to be maintained, which is same as that of the animal's body temperature. So directly when you allow that physiological salt solution to pass from the reservoir to the tissue bath, the temperature of that physiological salt solution will be normal, right? So it will take some time to attain that particular temperature. So to avoid that, a middle station is provided, that is known as a warming coil. So it is a tube-like, so coil-like structure. A glass tube is there, which is immersed in that water bath. So first the physiological salt solution will enter into this warming coil, and then it will go into the actual tissue bath. So before it enters the tissue bath, the temperature of that physiological salt solution is raised to the actual temperature of the water bath. Okay, then the next part is the tissue holder. Obviously, as the name implies, it is meant to hold the tissue. So one end of the tissue is tied to this tissue holder, and the second end is tied to the writing lever or the recording lever. Okay, actually this lever is responsible for recording the responses. So whatever tissue will contract and relax, all those recordings will be written on a particular paper known as chymograph paper. So with this pointer is present on that chymograph paper of this particular writing lever, and it will start recording all the responses. Whatever contraction, relaxation of your tissue, it will be recorded by this lever. Then apart from this, there are certain adjustable clamps, holders and grips to hold these several settings of writing lever or tissue holder in position on that organ bath to fix it over there. Okay, so this is to do with an organ bath, and this is known as a single unit organ bath. So one tissue bath is present over here. Now another scientist, Gadam, he developed a student organ bath which is having two units. So inside that water jackets, there are two tissue baths. Okay, so at a time two people can perform the experiment using the same assembly. So that's is known as a double unit. So either it will be available as a single unit or a double unit organ bath. Okay, now this is what actually the assembly will look like for isolated tissue experiments. Okay, so these are the three basic components. Okay, the first one is the chymograph. Okay, chymograph, it is actually a machine which allows you to make all the adjustments into this particular machine. Okay, so it's a digital one. So you can set over here the speed of this particular drum. This is known as a Sherrington's revolving drum, onto which the chymograph paper is attached, and over this the responses will be recorded. So for that matter, this particular drum will be revolving. So as the name implies, Sherrington's revolving drum. So it will be revolving at a particular speed, and that is adjusted on the shaft. The particular Sherrington's drum is placed. So this shaft will be rotating at a particular speed. Okay, so that speed can be adjusted over here. Now this is a digital one, so several adjustments are available, like mode, as to whether you want a CRC mode, the baseline, the time for which baseline should last, the contact time, time for which the contact time should last. So all can be adjusted, the speed of the drum. Okay, so all can be adjusted over here using this chymograph machine. Second part is the organ bath. This is what we have seen just now, the parts of the organ bath. Okay, so let's have a closer look at this particular organ bath. So this is a single unit organ bath with all the attachments which are shown over here. So as we can see over here, there is a heater. Okay, this is the outer jacket. Okay, so this is the water bath into which the water will be poured. Okay, in the outer jacket, it is fitted with an heater, and there is a temperature sensor also which is attached over here. Maybe it's behind this, is smaller than the heater. So heater will electrically heat the water in the water jacket, and temperature sensor will go on sensing the present temperature in that water bath. Okay, so that temperature you can set with the help of this digital temperature controller. So it is synchronized with this organ bath. So whatever temperature is set, it will be displayed over here. What is the current temperature and what is the set temperature? So it will let you know whether the water has attained a particular temperature or no. So this heater and the temperature sensor both will be working in a synchronized manner to adjust the temperature in the water bath. Okay. Then apart from this, we have seen that it has a pump also, this white colored box which can be seen over here behind. So that's a pump. So continuously it will be circulating the water which is present in the water bath. Okay. The next is the organ tube or the tissue bath. This tube-like structure which can be seen over here. So this is a tissue bath, a glass tissue bath into which actually the tissue is suspended. Physiological salt solution is present in this and into which the tissue is suspended with the help of tissue holder. This is the tissue holder which is actually placed inside the tissue bath. Okay, so one end of your tissue will be tied over here. There is a bend, and the second end will of your tissue, it will tissue will remain in middle over here, and the second end will be tied to the lever. This is the lever, recording lever. Okay, and apart from this, there is one more provision known as a warming coil. So as I've told you earlier, a physiological salt solution will be kept in a separate reservoir. So it will enter, this particular assembly has a provision to enter that solution in this organ tube. But before entering into this tissue bath, it will pass through this warming coil. A coil-like structure can be seen over here, glass tube. So it will first pass through this so that it will attain the temperature of the water bath, and then it will enter into this tissue bath. Okay, so this is to do with the setup for the isolated tissue experiments. Then coming to the recording levers. So there are different types of writing levers which can be used to record the contractions and relaxations of the isolated tissue. Okay, so usually these writing levers, these are light in weight. These must be light in weight because you are attaching your tissue, so it should not put excess of load, for which the balancing of the lever also is done. That's a very important step. They should be rigid enough. And generally these are made up of either aluminium or balsa wood or stainless steel or brass. So these are the different materials which are used to make the lever, recording levers. Now ideally these levers are of two types. Okay, either isotonic type or isometric type. Okay, so as the name implies, isotonic meaning here the tension of the muscle remains the same. Okay. And there is a change in the length of the tissue due to contraction. So this change in length of the tissue due to contraction, that is actually recorded. So examples of this type of lever are simple lever, frontal writing lever. And the second type of levers is isometric type of lever. So here, as the name implies, isometric meaning here the length of the tissue is kept constant, whereas the tension on, there is a change in the tension on the tissue. So this change in the tension is actually recorded. An example of this type of lever is Penton's oxytonic lever. Now coming to the some of the most commonly utilized or lever in the experimental pharmacology, the first one is a simple lever. So as the name implies, it's a very kind of simple arrangement which is made. Okay, usually it consists of an light aluminium or stainless steel capillary. This is the one capillary which is fitted onto the axle. Okay, which is pivoted in between these centers, two centers. It is fixed. Okay, into in between these two centers, raised brass frame. Okay, but this is not fixed actually. This whatever provision is there, axle, that is movable. So it is movable in such a way that the lever can move either upward or downward. So this is freely moving, this drum like structure which can be seen. Apart from this, this particular thumb screw which is present, it can be loosened so that this capillary can be adjusted. Okay, so if you loosen this thumb screw, this particular capillary, it is freed from this axil, so that you can adjust the length. This particular two lengths are very important. It determines the magnification value of that particular lever. We'll come to what magnification value is a little later. Okay, so it helps in adjustment of the magnification value. Apart from this, there is a stylus for writing on the smoke drum. So this provision was provided in the olden days wherein smoke drums were utilized. So that paper, thymograph paper, it was suited with the help of soot, black soot, and onto which this lever writes and it removes the soot. So responses will be recorded over there. Okay. Next type of lever is frontal writing lever. So this particular lever, okay, again the arrangement is similar to that of the simple lever. As we can see, the arrangement, axle, thumb screw is present, this capillary is present. So the difference is that there is a freely moving wheel which is available over here. Now there are two points. This is forward point and this is a backward point. So this forward point will be actually attached to the drum from the front, and this actually is, it can rotate 360 degrees, okay, onto this particular capillary. Okay, next commonly used lever is the Starling's heart lever. So as the name implies, this is a type of lever which is used to record the contractions and relaxations of the heart. So basically it consists of a frame onto which there is a adjustable hook over here. So it can be loosened so that it can move either upwards or downwards. So it is adjusted in such a way to hold this particular lever. Now this particular lever, if you remove the spring, there is a spring in between this lever and this particular hook, adjustable hook. Okay, so if you remove the spring, this lever will fall down actually. Okay, so to hold or to support this particular lever, this adjustment is provided. Because the heart will be somewhere over here, okay, at the tip of the heart, one pin is inserted and the thread is tied to the head of that pin and it is attached onto this lever. So to avoid excessive load onto the heart, this provision is provided so that it will support the lever. So you should make this adjustment in such a way that the lever will be held exactly horizontal. So it will not place any excessive pressure on the heart. So as the heart contracts, it will pull the lever upward, and as it relaxes, it will move the lever downwards. Okay, so this is commonly used for recording the responses of the heart. Then the next type of lever is Brodie's universal lever. Okay, so this particular lever, again, it is similar to that of heart lever, but the only thing is spring which is attached over here, it is horizontally attached. And there are several attachments which can be given, like, you know, one plain lever is there, one notched lever, okay, with holes, and one short lever can be provided. So it can be changed as per the type of the experiment. Then the next commonly used lever is the gimbal lever. Okay, gimbal lever has a fulcrum frame, just like the what the simple lever which is there, but there is slight difference over there. So a fulcrum frame is in such a way that there is a plate, a separate plate which is attached to a circular frame, and in between that there is a drum onto which the capillary is attached. So actual the plate onto which you are tying the tissue is not actually directly in contact with the pointer. So because of this arrangement, okay, so magnification of this lever increases to a greater level. Even this lever attaches the drum in a tangential manner so that it does not detach. With the frontal lever, what happens is commonly the lever may get detached if there are very big responses, which does not take place with the gimbal lever. Now here ink reservoirs are also provided so that the ink tip is there which will write onto the lever. Then the next type of lever is Patton's oxytonic lever, which actually is a light spring loaded lever in which the load on the muscle, it increases as it shortens. Okay, so next part is the recording procedures. Okay, so now while recording the responses, what are the different aspects which needs to be maintained? So the first point is the adjustment of the magnification. So as we have seen earlier in the recording levers, that we can adjust the lengths, okay, in between the writing point and the fulcrum. Okay, so that the magnification can be adjusted. Like when a particular tissue contracts, the contractions are so small that they can record very small responses. So we need to magnify those responses to a particular level. So for that matter, a particular magnification has to be set, okay, in order to get appropriate responses. Okay. Now those tissues which show less contractility, they may need more magnification, and those which show appropriate contractility, a less amount of magnification is sufficient generally. Okay. Now this adjustment of the magnification, it can be done by adjusting the distance, two distances. Distance between the fulcrum and the writing point, and the distance between the fulcrum and the point of attachment of the tissue. So these two distances can be adjusted to obtain a particular magnification of that particular response. Okay, so let us take a help of this particular figure. Okay, so if consider if this is a fulcrum. So fulcrum is a point of attachment of the lever to or the pointer to that particular axle. Okay, where a thumb screw is provided. So that's known as the fulcrum. So magnification value, that is how much magnification of that particular response is done, that can be adjusted with by adjusting these two distances, A and B. That is the distance between the fulcrum and the writing point. This is the writing tip, and the fulcrum and the point of attachment of tissue. Okay, so now how magnification value is described? It is a ratio in between the distance between the fulcrum and the writing point to the distance between the fulcrum and the point of attachment of the tissue. Okay, now say let us consider this with the help of an example. Say for example, if this distance A, that is from the fulcrum to the writing tip, if it is 10 centimeters. Okay, and this distance between the fulcrum and the point of attachment of tissue, if this is supposed to be 2 centimeters, so magnification value which has been adjusted is it can be calculated as 10 divided by 2. So the adjustment of the magnification is 5. So a particular response will be magnified 5 times. Okay, so likewise, the magnification may be adjusted. Okay, ideally it will depend upon the contractility of a particular tissue. Okay, so it can be appropriately adjusted because thumb screw can be loosened and this distance can be changed as per the requirement. Next is the application of load, or it is also called as the bezel tension. Okay, so now why this load is applied? Okay, usually this in this particular experiment on isolated tissue, you are going to add some drug which will make that tissue to contract. So now after contraction, the tissue should also relax appropriately. Okay, because many times the responses are repeated on the same tissue. So at that time you need to relax the tissue. The tissue is washed, the drug is removed, and then again the second dose may be added. So for relaxation of the tissue, this load plays a very important role. Okay, so this is also known as a basal tension. So every particular tissue has a particular basal tension that is ideal to that particular basal tone which that particular tissue has. So that is actually attached for the relaxation of the tissue. We'll take it with the help of an example. Okay, I'll show you how exactly and where exactly it is supposed to be added. Okay, first of all, to obtain ideal responses, you need to select an appropriate magnification for that particular tissue, okay, by changing the distance, okay, between the fulcrum and writing point and the fulcrum and the point of attachment of tissue, as we have seen. Next step is to balance the lever. Now usually this balance has a longer arm on this side, okay, this one. So usually it will fall on the left hand side. Okay, So this lever, before attachment of the tissue, it needs to be balanced. Otherwise, what will happen if you directly attach your tissue? If the lever is not balanced, it will put excess of pressure because you're tying your tissue over here. Tissue will be placed in the organ tube somewhere over here. So if the weight on this side is too much heavy, it will put a pressure on that tissue. Okay, so it may damage the tissue and you may not get appropriate responses. So for that matter, you need to balance this lever first, okay, before the attachment of the tissue. So for this reason, the extra weight, in this experiment, plasticine is actually used as the load. So whatever basal tension or the basal tone of that tissue which you have selected, that is weighed and that is attached at this particular point of attachment of tissue. Okay, so it will act as a basal tension, and then extra weight can be added at this particular point so that the lever remains horizontal as it is shown in the picture. Okay, so once the lever is balanced by adding excess load on this particular side, then this particular basal tension which you have applied at the point of attachment of tissue, it is removed from here and it is tied exactly at the equidistance on the opposite side of the fulcrum. Okay, so whatever this distance is, at the same distance on the opposite side of the fulcrum, that may be somewhere over here, this particular basal tension is tied. So once you record a response, a tissue is tied over here, response is recorded, it will pull the lever downwards so that the response is recorded. This side will move upwards and it will record a response. So in order to relax the tissue, you have to bring this lever back to normal, horizontal state. So tissue is washed and this weight which you have applied over here, okay, it is hanged with the help of a thread. So it will be brought down and it will help in relaxation of the tissue because it is applying tension on the opposite side. So it will help in pulling this lever downwards and will help in ultimately relaxing the tissue which is attached on this particular side of the fulcrum. Okay. Now, ideally, there are fixed tensions which are known. Okay, like for example, guinea pig ileum, if you're using, the basal tension is 0.5 grams, so it is weighed 0.5 grams and it is attached. Guinea pig trachea 0.2 gram, rabbit duodenum it's 1 to 3 grams, rat uterus 1 gram is the ideal basal tension. Then next part is the contact time. Okay, now what is a particular contact time? Now when you're recording a particular response, you're adding drug to that tissue bath, right, where you have placed the tissue. So it will act onto that tissue. There are receptors, so it will bind to the receptor and it will make that tissue to contract. Okay, now the time for which you allow your drug to remain in contact with your tissue is known as the contact time. Okay, you allow your drug to act for a particular time, right? Once you add the drug, immediately the tissue will not contract, right? It will take some time. It will bind to the receptor, then the further transducer mechanisms will take place, and then the tissue will contract or the muscle will contract. So that time which you are allowing for your drug to remain in contact with your tissue is known as contact time. Now this again, for how long you are keeping your drug in contact with the tissue, that will depend upon what type of tissue you have selected. Like say for example, if there are slow contracting tissues, like say frog rectus abdominis. So here contact time allowed is 90 seconds. A little bit more time is required, okay, because it contracts very slowly. So sufficient time must be allowed for recording a sufficient response, height with response with a sufficient height. On the other hand, the fast contracting tissues like guinea pig ileum, the contact time is just 30 seconds because it contracts very fast. Once you add the drug, immediately it will show the contraction. So here the contact time may be required is just 30 seconds. Okay, so it may be variable depending upon the type of the tissue which you are selecting. Then the last part is the physiological salt solution. So as we have discussed earlier, we need to provide all the conditions to keep that tissue alive, okay, isolated tissue alive. So for that matter, you may have to provide several electrolytes, energy may be required. Okay, so that is provided by suspending that tissue in a physiological salt solution. Okay, so this will provide all the necessary electrolytes and the energy for that tissue to survive till you finish your experiment. Okay, now this particular physiological salt solutions, there are different types depending upon what kind of experiment you are performing. Okay, so for preparing this physiological salt solution, analytical grade reagents may be required which are dissolved in the distilled water. Okay, so there are several precautions which you need to take while preparing this physiological salt solution. First of all, the proper adjustments of the pH must be required of the final solution. Bubbling with the air or oxygen may be required. Okay, so you need to use an aerator so that a continuous air must be bubbled through this physiological salt solution. So also physiological salt solution which you prepare, it should be clear. If it is turbid, it indicates that there is some chemical reaction which is taking place and it is not ideal. You need to prepare it fresh if it is turbid. Next care which you should take is that it should be prepared freshly. If you are performing an experiment, just before your experiment it should be prepared. It's not that if you prepare the solution today, physiological salt solution today, and you can't use it tomorrow. It should be used within 24 hours. So storage of this solution is not recommended because microbial growth can take place, because it contains several chemicals, nutrients. So it will support the growth of microorganisms. So it ideally it should not be stored. It should be freshly prepared. And one more precaution which should be taken care of is addition of the calcium chloride. It should be added at the end. Now, ideally when you are preparing a physiological salt solution, the prescribed chemicals are weighed, they are dissolved in smaller quantity of distilled water, and then they are added to the solution, concentrated solution is added to a larger amount of distilled water, and final volume is made up. Once all the constituents dissolve, the final volume is made up with the distilled water. It should not happen that if you are preparing 50 liters of solution, directly you cannot take 50 liters of distilled water and go on adding the chemicals to that. Ideally, it should be dissolved in smaller quantity, say 1 or 2 liters, and then it should be added to the distilled water which is present in the larger container. And one precaution you should take care is with the calcium chloride. If you are adding, it should be added at the end. Just before making up the volume, you should add calcium chloride. That too, ideally calcium chloride and potassium chloride are added in the form of solutions. Stock solution is prepared, 10% solution, and that is added at the end. Otherwise, the precipitation may take place. It may react with the bicarbonates and it may precipitate. So to avoid that, it is added at the end. So this is the composition of some of the commonly used physiological salt solutions. So these are the names of the chemicals which are required. Now usually all of them may not be required in a particular salt solution. So these are the different salt solutions: Frog Ranger, Ranger Lock, Digelon solution, Thyroid solution, or Krabs solution. So these are the names of chemicals. And if you can see, under a particular type of physiological salt solution, all of them are not used. So dash indicates magnesium chloride is not used. Okay. Now these values with single asterisk, the value which is given over here in the parenthesis, this is the molecular weight of this particular compound. Okay. Then the values which are given over here. Okay. So this indicates this, the one which is given over here, okay, outside the bracket, that is a value in millimoles, and the one which is given inside the bracket is the weight of this particular chemical in grams per liter. So per liter of the solution, 6 grams of NaCl is required. Okay, per liter of Frog Ranger, 0.14 of potassium chloride is required, and so on. Okay, so whatever physiological salt solution you want to prepare, you need to weigh these particular chemicals, dissolve it first in small quantity, and then make up to the final volume. Now ideally this thyroid solution is quite commonly used, okay, for experiments on say cork helium, which are preferably done nowadays. So here the NaCl required is 8 grams per liter. Supposing if you want to prepare 50 liters in bulk, okay, so it should be calculated accordingly. Okay, so 400 grams of this NaCl will be required for 50 liters of the thyroid solution. Then 0.2 grams of potassium chloride and 0.2 grams of calcium chloride. But ideally, it is not supposed to be weighed. A stock solution 10% is prepared and then it is added in terms of volume. It is corresponding volume is calculated, which will contain this much amount, and it is added at the end. It also contains magnesium chloride. Now it's a range which is given 0.1 to 1. So you, on the basis of your practical experience, you can select the amount of magnesium chloride. Then the sodium bicarbonate is required. Magnesium sulfate is not added. Sodium bicarbonate 1 gram per liter. Sodium dihydrogen phosphate 0.05, very less quantity is required per liter. And glucose 1 gram per liter. So this is the composition of thyroid solution. Okay, now let us see what is the role of each component. Okay, there is a specific role which an individual component will play over there. Okay, so sodium chloride, usually it helps in maintaining the isotonicity of the cell. Then sodium chloride, potassium chloride, it also helps in maintaining the membrane potential. Sodium bicarbonate, it helps to maintain the alkaline pH. Then potassium dihydrogen phosphate or sodium dihydrogen phosphate, these act as a buffer to maintain the pH in that set value. Then magnesium chloride or magnesium sulfate, it is required for the relaxation of the smooth muscle. Calcium is required for the contraction of these the smooth muscles. And glucose, obviously, it will provide the energy to the tissue for meant for the contraction. So these are the different roles which different components will play. So accordingly, it is selected in an appropriate amount. These are the references.